So students, let's continue with the alcohol and phenol chapter, and in this we are going to study about the test for differentiating the alcohols. So for differentiating the alcohols, we can use different tests by using which we can easily differentiate between the phenols or alcohols, or we can differentiate between the primary, tertiary and secondary alcohols. So the first test which we are going to see here is the Lucas test. Okay. This is the Lucas test. So Lucas test, what is Lucas test? So Lucas test is used to differentiate and categorize primary, secondary and tertiary alcohols. Okay, by using this test we can easily categorize the three alcohols, that is the primary alcohol, 1 degree alcohols, secondary alcohol, 2 degree alcohol and 3 degree alcohol from each other. Here we use a solution of anhydrous zinc chloride. Okay, here we use a solution of anhydrous zinc chloride, that is ZnCl2, anhydrous ZnCl2, which is also called as Lucas reagent. Okay, which is also called as Lucas reagent. And this solution is taken in concentrated hydrochloric acid, and this solution which is formed in hydrochloric acid from anhydrous ZnCl2, it is termed as Lucas reagent. The reaction here is displaying, it is been representing by forming turbidity. Okay, what is that? Means of cloudiness of the solution will be appeared out there. And by realizing the time, or by measuring the time for which the cloudiness, okay, how much time it is taking to for the solution to become cloudy there, that is the indication for the differentiation of the different alcohols. Okay, so here we will see that for the tertiary alcohols. Okay, first let's see about the reactions here. What is the reaction here? So the reaction here is when alcohols are reacted with HCl in the presence of anhydrous ZnCl2, that is Lucas reagent, then formation of chloroalkane will take place and water will be released out. Okay, chloroalkane, that is alkyl chloride, will take place, and this alkyl chloride is insoluble in water and it will form a cloudy solution there. So in the case of 3 degree alcohols, in the case of 3 degree alcohols, that is the primary tertiary alcohols, we will observe that immediately the reaction will happen and cloudiness will appear. Okay, immediately the cloudiness will appear in the solution. While in the case of secondary alcohol, we will see that within 5 minutes the cloudiness in the solution will be appeared out there. While in the case of primary alcohol, it will not react with the Lucas reagent at room temperature. Okay, it will not react with the Lucas reagent with at room temperature, but on heating, okay, on heating we will obtain cloudiness. Okay, so here this particular nature, that the tertiary alcohols will readily react with the anhydrous ZnCl2 to form cloudiness, okay, in the solution, while secondary alcohol will take some time, that is it will take more than 1 minute or 2 minute to form the cloudiness, while the primary alcohol will never react at the room temperature, but we have to heat it. Okay, so hence by using this method we can differentiate the tertiary, secondary and primary alcohol, and this is termed as Lucas test, because the reagent which we are using here, it is the Lucas reagent, and the Lucas reagent is nothing other than solution of anhydrous ZnCl, anhydrous ZnCl2 in HCl, okay, with HCl. So let's move further and see the next test for alcohols. So the next test for alcohol is the Victor Mayer's test. Okay, Victor Mayer test. This test involves the different steps here. Okay, and the different steps are given here. So the given alcohol is treated with red phosphorus first. Okay, what we will do? We will just treat the given alcohol with red phosphorus in the first step and iodine. And iodine in the resulting in the formation of corresponding alkyl iodide. So you can see here in the first step what we are doing. The given alcohols, they are treated with the red phosphorus and iodine. Okay, so on treating the alcohols with red phosphorus and iodine, we will see that the formation of corresponding iodide will take place. Okay, the formation of corresponding iodide has been taken place. After that, the alkyl iodide is treated with silver nitrite. Okay, we will treat the alkyl iodide which is formed out here. It will be treated with silver nitrite. Silver nitrite. So, on treating it with silver nitrite, it will form corresponding nitroalkanes. Okay, here the formation of corresponding nitroalkane will take place. Then, we will further react with it nitrous acid, that is HNO2, and HNO2 is prepared by NaNO2 plus sodium nitrate, nitrite plus sulfuric acid. Okay, so this will be nitrous acid will be prepared here by sodium nitrite and sulfuric acid here, which will be reacted with the nitrate, corresponding nitrate which were formed, and we will get here the nitrolic acid in the case of the primary alcohols, which will give a blood red color. Okay, it will give blood red color with the alkali here. And in the case of secondary alcohol, what will happen? In the case of secondary alcohol here, we will see that in the case of secondary alcohol, we will see that pseudo nitrile has been formed out here, which will give blood color with alkali. Okay, it will give blue color, sorry, not blood color, it is blue color with alkali. Okay, it will give blue color with alkali. And in the condition, in the case of tertiary alcohols, no action will take place and no specific color will be seen out there. A colorless solution will be there. Okay, it will form a colorless solution. So by using the Victor Mayer test also, we can differentiate the secondary, primary and tertiary alcohols from each other. Okay, so here the three steps are there. In the first step, what we are doing, we are reacting red phosphorus and iodide with the given unknown alcohol to form corresponding iodides. Okay, to form the corresponding iodides. Then this iodide is been treated with silver nitrite to obtain the corresponding nitro compounds. Okay, to obtain the corresponding nitro compounds. Then the nitro compounds are further treated with the nitrous acid to form either first is the nitrolic acid in the case of primary alcohol, which will give blood red color. Then in the case of secondary alcohol, we will get a pseudo nitrile, which is having blue color with alkali, which is showing blue color with alkali. And in the case of tertiary alcohol, colorless solution will be formed. Okay, a colorless solution will be formed out there. So this is the Victor Mayer's test. Next test which we are going to see here is the iodoform test. Okay, next is the iodoform test. All alcohols containing the CH3CHOH group. Okay, all alcohols which are containing the CH3COOH group here can be identified by the iodoform test. Iodoform test can be used to identify the presence of carbonyl compound groups in alcohol. The reaction of iodine along with the base with methyl ketones results in the appearance of very pale yellow precipitate of the triiodomethane. Okay, here triiodomethane has been formed, which is forming a pale yellow colored precipitate. Pale yellow colored precipitate will be formed out here. The triiodomethane reaction can be used to identify the presence of CH3 group, CHOH group also in the alcohols. There are two apparently quite different mixtures of reagent that can be used to do this reaction, but are chemically equivalent. Both them are chemically equivalent. This is chemically the more obvious method. Iodine solution is added to small amount of alcohol, followed by just enough sodium hydroxide solution to remove the color of the iodine. If nothing happens in the cold, it may be necessary to warm the mixture very gently. Okay, so the simple process here is that we will react the given unknown alcohol with the iodine and add NaOH there. Okay, sodium hydroxide will be added there. So on adding NaOH here, we will prepare triiodomethane, which is also called as iodoform, which is having yellow precipitate. And if yellow precipitate has been formed out there, then it will be showing that it is having either secondary or either tertiary alcohol. Okay, either secondary or either tertiary alcohol can be present out there. Next, in the case of secondary alcohol also, we will find out that iodoform has been formed out there. But in the case of methanol, that is the primary alcohol, no reaction will take place. Okay, no reaction will take place here, and hence it can be easily identified here that the given solution, okay, the given alcohol is either primary, either tertiary, or either secondary. So these were the different tests which can be used to identify the primary, secondary, and tertiary alcohols. Next, we can use more tests for differentiating the phenols from the alcohols. Okay, to differentiate between phenols and alcohols also, we can use some tests. So the first test is the litmus test. Okay, in case of phenols, for the litmus test, in the case of phenol, we will observe that phenol converts blue litmus solution to red, while alcohols do not react with the litmus solutions. Okay, next, by using bromine water also we can distinguish phenols and alcohols. In the case of bromine water, phenol reacts with bromine water to form white precipitate. Okay, phenol reacts with bromine water to give white PPT of 2, 4, and 6. Okay, 2, 4, 6. Tribromobenzene. Okay, tribromophenol, which is having white precipitate. While in the case of no white precipitate has been formed out here in the case of the alcohols. Okay, next is the sodium hydroxide test, NaOH test. So NaOH test, phenol reacts with NaOH to form sodium salt. Phenol reacts with sodium hydroxide, that is NaOH, to form sodium salts. While in the case of alcohols, no reaction will take place. Okay, no reaction will take place with NaOH here. Sodium hydroxide will not react with the alcohols. So hence, by using these methods, we can easily differentiate between the phenols and the alcohols. So next is the interconversion of alcohols. How we can interconvert the alcohols between them? Means how we can convert the primary alcohols to secondary alcohols, and how we can convert the secondary alcohols to primary alcohols, or directly primary alcohols to tertiary alcohols. Okay, so here, what is the method? So the method is that primary alcohols are oxidized to be converted into aldehydes. Then these aldehydes are additioned to hydrogenation of the hydrogen will be done out here to form the secondary alcohols. In the case of secondary alcohols conversion to tertiary alcohols, we will oxidize the secondary alcohols for the formation of ketones here. Then ketones will be hydrogenated to form the tertiary alcohols. Okay, so this is the process for interconversion of the alcohols, and I have taken some examples also here. So the first example here is to convert propane 1-ol to propane 2-ol, that is conversion of primary alcohol to secondary alcohol. So here propane 1-ol is oxidized, or it is first converted to haloalkane, that is chloroalkane, by using thionyl chloride. Okay, propane 1-ol is reacted with thionyl chloride to form the chloropropane. Okay, chloropropane. Now chloropropane is reacted with alcoholic KOH. Okay, it is reacted with alcoholic KOH to form propene. Okay, to form the propene. Then propene is reacted with hydroboric acid. Okay, hydrobromic acid, and the formation of 2-bromopropane will take place here. Now this 2-bromopropane is again treated with aqueous KOH, that is alkali KOH, which will form the propane 2-ol. Okay, so hence this is the process for conversion of propane 1-ol to propane 2-ol. Here it is first reacted with thionyl chloride to form chloroalkane. Then chloroalkane is treated with alcoholic KOH to form propene or alkene. Then alkene is treated with HBr to form 2-bromoalkane. Then 2-bromoalkane is further reacted with KOH, aqueous KOH, to form propane 2-ol. Next is the conversion of propane 2-ol to propane 3-ol. That is, secondary alcohol is been converted to tertiary alcohol. So here, propane 2-ol is first oxidized. Okay, the oxidation of the propane 2-ol is taken place here by using potassium dichromate. So here on oxidation we will obtain ketone, that is acetone is been obtained out here. Then acetone is reacted with RMGX, that is Grignard reagent, which is CH3MgBr in this case, and it will form an addition reaction. Okay, addition compound will be formed out here. It will undergo addition reaction and addition compound will be formed out here. Three alkyl groups will get attached to the central carbon atom here, to the ketone carbon atom here. Then the hydrogenation will be occurred out here by using the hydrolysis process, and after this MgOHBr will be separated out, and we will get 2-methylpropane-2-ol, that is tertiary alcohol will be obtained out here. Next is the reaction of 1-degree alcohol. Okay, process of converting 1-degree alcohol to directly tertiary alcohol. So here what we will do, we will first react, we will first dehydrate here. Okay, dehydrate the primary alcohol. So for dehydration we will use concentrated sulfuric acid, and we will warm the solution. Okay, so on warming the solution we will obtain alkene here. Okay, we will obtain alkene, that is 2-methylprop-1-ene. Okay, 2-methylprop-1-ene will be obtained out here. Now it will be reacted with the hydrogen bromide. Okay, hydrogen bromide HBr. So here by using the Markovnikov rule, the carbon which is containing more hydrogen, the H will get attached to them, the positive addendum will get attached to that, and the negative addendum will move towards the carbon which is having less carbon here, less hydrogen here. Okay, so here the formation of 2-bromo-2-methyl propane will take place, and after that we will react this compound, bromo compound with the haloalkane compound with the aqueous KOH to form the 2-methylpropane-2-ol, that is a tertiary alcohol. Okay, so this is the process to convert 1 degree directly to tertiary alcohol. This is the process to convert the second degree alcohol, that is 2 degree alcohol, secondary alcohol to tertiary alcohol, and the first process is to convert the 1 degree alcohol to 2 degree alcohol. So let's move next and see the conversion of lower alcohols into higher alcohol. How to convert the lower alcohols into higher alcohol, and this is termed as accent of series. Okay, so here let's take an example for the methanol. So methanol is reacted with iodic acid, hydroiodic acid. It will form iodoform, okay, CH3I. It will form iodoform. Then iodoform is been treated with KCN, okay, potassium cyanide. It is treated with potassium cyanide. It will form cyanoalkane, okay, that is cyanomethane here. So methyl cyanide will be formed out here. Then methyl cyanide will be reduced, okay, it will be reduced to amines. It will be reduced to amines, which is ethylamine here, and ethylamine is then treated with nitrous acid to form ethanol. Okay, ethylamine is then treated with nitrous acid to form ethanol. In the case of descent series, means to convert higher alcohols into the lower alcohols, here what we will do, here we will follow this reaction, that ethanol, such as we are taking ethanol, it will be first oxidized. It will be first oxidized to carboxylic acid. Okay, it will be first oxidized to carboxylic acid. Then the carboxylic acid here, it will be treated with the NaOH, that is sodium hydroxide, to form sodium salt of carboxylic acid. Then the carboxylic sodium salt of carboxylic acid is treated with soda lime, and heating is been done out here to form alkane. Now this alkane is halogenated, such as we are using here chlorine, and the chloroalkane, which is formed after the halogenation, it will be treated with aqueous KOH, that is aqueous potassium hydroxide, to form alcohol here. So here we will see that we have degraded, we have just removed one carbon atom from the alcohol. So to convert lower alcohol into higher alcohol, accent of series method will be used, where we will be first reacting the alcohol with hydroiodic acid, then formation of iodoform will take place, then it will be reacted with potassium cyanide, formation of cyanoalkane will take place, then reduction will be taken here, and formation of, on reducing the cyanoalkane, okay, on reducing the cyanoalkane, that is this alkyl cyanide, we will produce alkyl amine, which will having one more carbon as comparison to that of the taken alcohol here, okay, and then it will be reacted with nitrous acid to form the higher alcohol. Similarly, higher alcohol to be converted into lower alcohol means descent of the series. What we will do, we will first oxidize the taken alcohol in the presence of potassium dichromate, and due to oxidation, formation of carboxylic acid will take place. Then carboxylic acid is treated with sodium hydroxide to form sodium salt of carboxylic acid here. Then the sodium salt of carboxylic acid is reacted with soda lime, okay, to form alkanes, and alkane is then halogenated to form haloalkane. Then haloalkane is treated with the aqueous KOH, that is potassium hydroxide, to form alcohol, which is having one carbon less than that of the parent alcohol, which has been used out. So this is the different methods to convert alcohols from one to another. Now let's start the next part of our chapter, that is ethers. That is the ethers. So what are ethers? Ethers are the compounds which are containing ROR. It can be ROR dash also. Okay. So ROR dash is the general formula for the ether. So isomerism in ether. Which kind of isomerism in ether can be seen? So in ether, the first time of isomerism which can be seen is the chain isomerism. Chain isomerism. So here, from a single molecular formula, we can form different molecular formula, different structural formula, such as I am making one methoxybutane. Okay, one, this is one methoxybutane. The chain here can be changed out, CH3, CH2, sorry, CH3, O, CH2, CH2, CH3, CH3. This can become one methoxy, two methyl propane. Okay, and similarly, one more example can be taken out here, CH3, O, CH, CH3, CH2, CH3. Here the name will be 2-methoxybutane, 2-methoxybutane. Okay, so this is the chain isomerism which can be represented in the ethers. Next is the functional group isomerism. Okay, functional group isomerism can also be seen out there in the case of the ethers. So here CH3O, CH3, which can form methoxymethane, which is a ether, but with this formula only we can form alcohols also, that is ethyl alcohol. So it will show functional group isomerism also. Similarly, CH3O, CH2, CH3, that is methoxyethane. Methoxyethane, and with the similar formula we can form propanol. Okay, so functional group isomerism can also be represented by using the ethers molecular formula. Next is the metamerism. Metamerism. So here the change in the chain can be observed out with the same molecular formula. Okay, so this is the one that is ethoxyethane, or we can metamerize this and form methoxy propane here. The formula will be same for both these two, but the compound will be changed out here, and here ethoxyethane will be formed and here methoxymethane will be formed out here. Means the symmetrical chain can be converted into unsymmetrical chain by using this formula. Okay, so this is the metamerism. Okay, this is the metamerism, means ROR is converted to ROR dash here. So this is known as metamerism. Now let's see the structure for the ether. So the structure for the ether is that carbon is connected to the central oxygen here in the bent structure. Okay, in the bent structure here, and the carbon here is sp3 hybridized. Both the carbons here are sp3 hybridized, which is forming sigma bond with the sp3 hybridized orbital of the oxygen here, and two lone pairs of the oxygen is present like this. Okay, these are the two lone pair of oxygen. These are the alkyl groups. And the bond angle here for the carbon atom, here it is 111. Okay, 111.7 for the carboxylic acid, for the ether here, and the bond length is 104 141 picometers. Okay. Now let's start the preparation methods for ether. Preparation methods for ether. So the preparation method for ether, the first is the dehydration of alcohol. Dehydration of alcohol. So here in the dehydration of alcohol, two different methods are there. The first method is to dehydrate alcohol in the presence of sulfuric acid. We will form CH2 double bond CH2, that is ethene. And the second method is to dehydrate the alcohol with sulfuric acid but at lower temperature, that is 413 Kelvin, to form CH3CH2OCH2CH3, that is ethoxyethane. Okay, so if higher temperature is taken from 413 Kelvin, then the formation of dehydration of the alcohol will take place to ethene. But if it is kept near about it, if it is kept till 413 degree Kelvin or 413 Kelvin only, then we can prepare the ether. Okay, that is ethoxyethane. The limitation of this method is that it is used, dehydration of alcohol is used for preparing symmetrical alcohols. Okay, it is generally used for preparing symmetrical ethers. Okay, we cannot use it for preparing unsymmetrical ethers because it will prepare in this reaction we will obtain different mixture of reaction. Okay, if we are trying to prepare here unsymmetrical ethers here. Okay, so here we will obtain mixture of ethers here. So it will be hard to separate this ether from each other. Okay, so for general method, what we will use here? We will use this method for preparing the symmetrical ethers only. Okay, unsymmetrical ethers will not be prepared from this method. Next is the next method is the Williamson's synthesis. The next method is the Williamson's synthesis. It is one of the important method. Okay, so here in the Williamson synthesis, sodium alkoxide is reacted with haloalkanes to form ether with sodium halide. Okay, and to form sodium alkoxide here, what we will do for the formation of sodium alkoxide, the alcohols will be treated with sodium here. Okay, to form the sodium alkoxide. Okay, sodium alkoxide will be formed out here by this. So here, what is the mechanism for the reaction here? So the alkoxide which is formed out here, okay, the alkoxide which is formed out here, it will react with the alkyl group of the haloalkane. Okay, and here the halide which is present with the haloalkane, it will take the electron pair, okay, from the haloalkane. It will take the electron pair from the alkyl group here to form the halide ion here. Okay, and the alkoxide from the sodium alkoxide, the sodium ion which has been released out there, it will react with the halide ion there. And here the formation of ether will take place with the halide ion. Okay, so this is the reaction here. So here we can take example for CH3CH2OH, which is first reacted with sodium to form ethyl sodium ethoxide. Okay, sodium ethoxide. Then this sodium ethoxide is reacted with ethyl bromide here. Okay, it will be reacted with ethyl bromide to form NaBr, that is sodium bromide, and CH3CH2CH2CH3, that is ethoxyethane will be prepared out here. Okay, so here we can see that here we can prepare both type of, that is symmetrical alcohols, symmetrical ethers can also be prepared, and unsymmetrical ethers can also be prepared. Okay, for taking the example, I am taking here ethyl bromide to be reacted with sodium methoxide. Okay, so here the preparation of methoxyethane. Okay, methoxyethane will take place here. Methoxyethane will take place here. So here NaBr will be produced. Okay, so this is the Williamson synthesis. This is the Williamson synthesis. Here we can prepare aromatic ethers also by using this Williamson. By using this method, we can prepare the aromatic compounds also. Okay, aromatic ethers also. So here, let us say we are taking sodium phenoxide. Sodium phenoxide plus CH3Br. Okay, CH3Br we are taking. So here, this CH3Br, it will react with the sodium here. This O minus will react with the alkyl group here to form anisole. Okay, it will be forming out here anisole. Anisole. Okay, it will be forming out here anisole. Next is the this is the Williamson synthesis. Okay, this is the Williamson synthesis. And the last is the last method for preparation of ether is the from alkyl halide. So here alkyl halide such as ethyl bromide, two molecules are reacted with silver oxide and heating is been done out here to form, to obtain AgBr. 2 AgBr will be obtained out here, and the left compounds will combine with each other, that is CH3CH2O CH2CH3, that is ethoxyethane will be formed out here. Okay, diethyl ether or ethoxyethane will be formed out here. So this was the methods for preparation of ethers. In the next class we are going to see the physical properties and the chemical properties for the ethers, and we will end this chapter. So thank you. Today we will meet in the next class.